So coming back to thinking skills, the skills that we were discussing, so that you can become, we all can become good leaders. So, you know, it is always, he should be able to identify and understand the problem, think through them and see a bigger picture. He should not just keep crying about why this has happened, why that has happened. He should be a mature individual to actually, you know, understand that why this problem has occurred, why, you know, how can he come out of that situation? And also not only about himself, but also think through for the team, that how my team can come out of it, how the group of people that I'm leading can come out. He should think holistically and see a bigger picture that, fine, I can come out of it, and how I should be able to make my team come out of it. Right? Then, communication skill. It is very important for us to actually communicate effectively. You know, most of the time, the problems occurs within a team when the manager or the leader, they are unable to actually, you know, communicate properly. You know, a lot of time it happens like a Chinese whisper, that I got some kind of responsibility and I have to delegate that responsibility. I have to communicate something to my colleagues. I have to communicate something to the employees, but I'm unable to do it effectively because I don't possess those skills. So to become a good leader, you know, you should have those skills, which are called communication skills. Then is delegation. What is delegation? Delegation is when you have to delegate something to your employees, when you have to empower your juniors, your subordinates to do something. You know, when you have to provide very clear-cut information and expectations, when you have to provide a clear-cut agenda, a clear-cut strategy to the colleagues that you're working with as a leader. Once he delegates the task, you know, when a leader has to empower the team to work in a particular manner, then he has to give the continuous support, suggestion, and assistance. It is not that today you're giving any kind of information to your colleagues. You're communicating very effectively, but what after that? You're delegating very effectively. It is the wholesome responsibility, you know, that you keep assisting your team, that you're continuously giving support and suggestions to the team for their improvement. A responsible leader is aware that he gains his leadership skill from the knowledge of other leaders. You know, there are a lot of managers who have this kind of an ego that we don't want to see what other managers are doing. Probably the other manager is doing much better, but we won't listen. We don't want to know, because that's kind of the trait that a normal manager or a boss, they possess. But if you're a good leader, it is very important. It is, you know, kind of a rich quality that you must possess, that you learn from others. It is not necessary. We as human beings, right? There's always a scope of improvement. Let's accept it. It's better we let all accept this, that there's always a scope of improvement. And when we say scope of improvement, how do we improve? By seeing each other, by looking at what other leaders are doing, transforming ourselves, you know, upgrading our skill sets. So once you delegate something, it is also your responsibility that you enhance your team, start imitating you to become leaders themselves. Then decision-making. I think most of us, we get very worried when there has to be a decision to be made. I know, you know, there's a fear, there's an anxiety in all of us. Jab hame koi decision lena hota hai, whether chota, bada, good, bad, worst, any kind of a decision, but because we don't know the outcome, we don't know what will follow after taking that decision. So to be a good leader, it is important to hold that skill where you're ready to take decisions. Whether you don't take years and months to take a decision, but you can take a decision and stand for its consequences, whether it is good, bad, or worst. You know, the more decisions you will keep making in your life, in your professional life, in your personal life, they will not only empower you, but they will give you an experience, a rich experience, which can be used later. Today, I'm taking a decision that I want to change my career, for example. It is my responsibility to stand for if that second career option is good or bad later on. So it is important that you hold that skill of taking a right, not a right decision, but of taking a decision. Right or wrong will be judged later. You know, you should be capable enough to make those decisions. You should act fast if you want to become a good leader. Because if you fail, if you If you are unable to take decision, if you fail to take a decision, then your team is standing still. Your team is unable to perform because they don't have a decision. So for that, you have to be proactive in taking decisions. Another thing, very important thing is competency. What is that? You know, it is our ability to perform. It is our, as I said, that when you take decisions, you get experiences out of it. And those experiences, that skills, those knowledge make you competent. When you go for job interviews, there are a lot of time, you know, the interviewer, they said that we are looking for very competent, staff members. And when they say competent, they mean that they want to look forward for somebody who's very rich in his skill set, who's very, you know, rich in the experience and has vast knowledge. That is the competency. That is that how competent you are, right? Competency can be thought as a state of quality of being well qualified to perform a task. For example, I go for an interview and I want to be hired for a position of a director. Of course, I need to be competent enough, well qualified enough. I should have that particular skills. I should have that quality. I should have that experience to perform my duties as a director, right? So we all have to keep upgrading our competency. We should all keep evolving ourselves as individuals so that we become more and more competent by time. They are probably most closely, you can, you know, the word that you can use for your competencies are your abilities, ability to perform a task, ability to lead a team, ability to become a leader, right? So what are the 7 leadership competencies? If you're becoming a good leader, what abilities you should have there? Like you should be able to influence others. You should be able to fostering accountabilities. You should be able to create a very positive work environment. You should be able to coach your team for improvement. You should be able to communicate very effectively, working very effectively, and building a high-performing team. So coming back to the first point of influencing others, what do you mean by influencing others? You know, a leader must have the ability to win respect. Respect is something that has to be won. It can't be imposed. You can't impose that, okay, I'm your boss, so please respect me. No, we can't do that, right? What is the competency to become a good leader is that I perform, I influence people in such a way that they eventually start respecting me as a leader. They are happy to be, you know, led by me, and I am also happy to follow, you know, team of people. He gives direction. He set high standards, right way to influence. So as a leader have to perform, and, you know, if I say that the abilities that I should have to become a good leader is that I should be able to earn that respect. I should be able to influence you to perform your work. I should be able to guide you, not order you, but guide you to perform your responsibilities. Then fostering accountabilities. When I say fostering accountabilities, accountability is a big word, right? You know, a leader should actually create that kind of an atmosphere and a culture in the team where each team member understands the accountability, where each team member is committed to achieve the results, where each team members is handled in such a beautiful manner that whatsoever is the problem, whatsoever is the hurdle, they are able to jump through that and fulfill their responsibilities because they know that a leader is standing by them, with them, a leader is there for them, and he will be able to help them, right, to overcome any kind of a problem. So it is very important that a leader should be able to enroll, not order, but enroll his team member to perform in a certain manner. Building positive working atmosphere or a relationship. This, I think we all can understand that it is very important for us as human beings, especially that, you know, we need a very happy, contented kind of an environment if we want to generate result. So it is very, you know, it's a mere responsibility or an ability a leader should possess so that he can create a very happy atmosphere around its employees. It should not be a very bossy atmosphere. It should not be any, you know, disrespecting behavior. There should not be any kind of a negative politics and everything like that. And should be a happy, contented working atmosphere. And when we work in a happy atmosphere, we obviously produce double the results. Coaching for improvement. As I mentioned earlier, that, you know, there's always a scope of improvement. So a leader should be able to actually understand that what kind of improvement he needs to work on when it comes to his team members, right? He should appreciate that strength. He should work on, he should know his team member actually. He should know that which skills his team member is lacking in, which skills are need to be upgraded. What are the core strength area? What are the core weaknesses of his team member so that he can work on that? He can coach them, he can guide them, he can help them so that they can keep improving, what we also can call self-improvement. Then once again, communicating effectively, we have done this point earlier also, that a leader should know how to communicate effectively, how to actually help, you know, structure the team, give strategies, you know, review the outcomes, give feedbacks, but all in a right way. There's always a way of communicating. If you're not doing anything right, I can scold you, I can shout on you, but politely I can say that you have done this very nice. It can be done in a particular manner as well, right? So you just have to communicate in a way so that it doesn't, if you know, impact another person in a negative manner. So a leader should be able to communicate effectively, working effectively. As a leader, I have a lot of load, right? As a leader, I have to, you know, lead a team of about 20 odd people. I have to keep upgrading them. I have to work on their skill sets. I have to, you know, care for their being. I have to care if they are having any kind of a problem. I have to make sure that the working atmosphere is happy. Similarly, I have to also work on myself. As a leader, I have to plan the things. I have to strategize them. I have to prioritize what has to be done first and what has to be done last. I also have to create good processes, good, you know, systems, habits in my own team so that eventually my team can successfully achieve the targets. So working on my own self, prioritizing my own, you know, task sheets and workloads, it is very important for me so that if I am managed, I am organized, I am self-disciplined as a leader, I can effectively impact my whole team like that. So working effectively on my own self, it is also an important ability or leadership competencies. Then I'm building a high performance team. At the end of the day, whatever a leader or a manager is doing, they are doing so that they can have a good high performing team, right? So he should communicate the team the way it should be communicated, should stand, give feedback. Also, very important factor is to celebrate. And when you celebrate small achievements of your team members, they motivate them to do further. They motivate them to do bigger things. So you have to also, as a leader, build a very high performance team. Coming to the managerial areas, the management skills that you need, they are very few. Because you have to be very technical, you have to be very straightforward in your things. So there are three types of skills now, what you all need to have if you want to become a good manager. See, it is an individual choice that whether you want to become a leader or you want to become a manager, right? So to become a manager, there is a very simple three kind of skills. One is technical, human, and conceptual. What is technical? You should know your area, as simple as that. If you're working for, you know, a textile industry, if you're working for an aviation industry, you should know your area. You should know, you know, the techniques that you have to follow, the processes that you have to follow, the tools that you have to follow. You just have to have that kind of an ability, theoretical or practical, so that you're technical enough to perform your responsibilities. Then is the human skill. You should know how to actually and effectively interact with people. Irrespective of you're interacting humbly, sweetly, nicely, communicating properly or not, you should just know how to interact. You should be able to, you know, mix with your group of people. Then is the conceptual. When I say conceptual skills, it is like you should be able to formulate ideas. You should be able to solve problems. You should be able to solve problems technically in your particular area. You should be able to formulate any kind of new tasks, new ideas, abstract relationships, but all according to your technical skills, all according to your specific area of working. Thus, technical skills deal with things. What all do you know about your work? What all do you, you know, do in your work area? Human skills concerns people. You should know how to talk to people. You should know how to balance relationship with people. And conceptual skills, they only have to do something with the ideas, that you can conceptualize something, that you can work on the abstract things, that you can, you know, work, go from concrete to abstract modes, right? Then what are the functions of a manager? Very simple flowchart. They plan, they do the planning, they organize things. For example, I have to organize an event, so I do a planning about it. Then I, you know, collate all the collaterals which are required to organize things, like I organize things, then I direct. I direct it to my team that this has to be done by XYZ, this has to be done by ABC, this has to be done by DEF, things like that. And then I control. I sit on my chair and I only take reports. I don't stand with them as a manager. I only sit here and keep controlling my staff members. Like, have you done this? Have you done that? So if we go back to the first leadership skill set, leaders, they stand by them. They stand with their team. After delegation of work, after direction, giving direction about the work, they are standing with their teams. They are continuously assisting them. They are continuously trying to, you know, solve the problems coming in their way. But as a manager, I am sitting and only taking reports. So here I want any one of you to just mention that, what do you want to become? You want to become a leader or a manager? Or also I want now that if you have any kind of a question, so you can please ask me. Because if I talk personally about myself, then I want to anyway become a leader than to become a manager. Yeah. So anybody who wants to share anything, or, okay, we have Surbhi saying that she wants to become a leader. Well done, Surbhi. I think I am able to do little justice to my comparison of leadership and management skills. Anybody else? Everybody leader, beautiful. I mean, that's really, really beautiful that you all want to become leaders. And I wish that you all possess that kind of a skill set, or we all as an individual, as a human being, can work on those skill sets to become good leaders. Any kind of a question, guys? Anything you want to know, any kind of a situation you must have come across, if you're actually working as leaders or managers, or you have any question where, you know, you're unable to handle team, or you want to handle a team in a particular way, but you're just not finding a way. So feel free to ask this question before we close the session. So I guess I think you all are. Fine. I think it was a wonderful, you know, opportunity given by Captain Shekhar to me to come and, you know, talk about, this is a very close topic, that this topic is pretty close to me also when it comes to leadership and managers. We have a question, how to motivate? It's a very, you know, vast thing to discuss, that how to motivate. See, it is not necessary. I understand that we all, most of the team members, they are working for the monetary gains, and, you know, 90% of the people, they get motivated when it comes to, you know, they are getting monetary benefits out of it. But as a leader, if you want to motivate, it is very important that you have one-to-one conversation. And when I say one-to-one conversation, is that if I as leader want to motivate any team member of mine, I would want to call that team member, make him or her sit with me, probably order a good cup of coffee and talk it out. You know, nowadays in 21st century and in early 30s, and, you know, people who are in early 30s or early 35, you know, they get motivated when they talk it out. They don't get a right way to actually communicate their things. Once you listen to them, it is very important that we give listening to our team members, right? It is very, you know, important for us to actually understand the problem that a team member is facing and address those issues. Address those issues, solve those issues, probably over an informal or a formal kind of a conversation, and you're good to go. The staff member will feel lighter. The staff member will feel happier because he has, you know, talked that out. So this is how, I guess, you can motivate your team members, or you can just speak to them, listen to them. What is the new normal post-COVID? Vibha, you have to be a little more elaborate. What do you want to understand by a new normal? Post-COVID, new normal is that, you know, we are still maintaining kind of a social distancing. We are still maintaining kind of a hygiene factor. And, you know, we are, I understand it is difficult for us to meet 20, 40 odd people, but it's just that stay connected with your people. If you're working for corporates, if you're working for any kind of an industry, stay connected. Talk yourself out. Eat healthy, stay fit. And I think when you're healthy, both physically and mentally, your productivity increases, right? So in my opinion, a new normal has to be that instead of only caring about our personal and professional needs, we also have to start caring about our mental wellness.
Anyone, any more questions? Any guys? This topic is just awesome.
Thank you, sir. I think that was kind of you to give me this opportunity to
come. It's very good opportunity for these guys to learn something because they are on a very initial phase of their career.
Absolutely.
Very important for them to learn such kind of, they'll be very clear now what is the difference between manager and the leader.
Absolutely. And I, on a very personal level, would want these students and these people who are now getting into the corporate world to actually think themselves as leaders, right?
Exactly.
They are bahut mil jayenge managers, but a good leader, very difficult to get. And once you find, everything else follows.
And the basic difference is just a mindset, I guess.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Once you have mindset of leader.
Actually, you know, how you tackle your team.
Correct.
Yeah.
So, Mansi, I think it's your time to finish the session. Mansi? Are you there?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
We would like to.
Go ahead.
We would like to propose a hearty vote of thanks to Vibhuti Taneja for gracing today's webinar and delivering the important topic on leadership skill, that is, leaders versus managers. I am sure that all the participants have taken note of your suggestion and will initiate that further in their career. Lastly, we thank you again on the behalf of the whole Aircrews Aviation Private Limited team. It was an amazing and interesting session, ma'am. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Mansi. It was indeed a pleasure to be part of this.